Welcome to the Faith Lutheran Church Bible Study, The Triumph of the Lamb, a study in Revelation. Tonight in our Wednesday class, we finish our discussion on the letters to the seven churches. We finished last week's discussion on Philadelphia from Revelation chapter 3, verse 7 to 13, and discussed the letter to the church in Laodicea from Revelation chapter 3, verse 14 to 22. Let's listen in.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for this night together and for this time to study your word. We pray, Lord, that as we do so, you would grant us your spirit so that our conversation would be fruitful. We would learn to believe rightly on what these texts are teaching us, and our lives would be shaped in accordance with them, Father. We thank you for the forgiveness and the promises that you give to us. We pray, Lord, that those would guide us in all that we do. Lord, tonight we come to you with heavy hearts for very many reasons. We come asking for you to have mercy on Ben's family as they mourn his loss. Father, this is a tragic situation, and it's beyond comprehension. So, Lord, we pray for your mercy to be on that family. Give them peace at this time. While they mourn, point them to the promise of the resurrection, and may they find hope in you in such a hopeless situation. I pray also for my friend Ben and his family as they mourn the loss of his brother at the funeral this week. I pray, Father, that you would give them peace and remind them your baptismal promises that are stronger even than suicide, Lord. I pray mercy on both of these situations. And, Father, we thank you that in the midst of this darkness, we do have the great hope of the return of your Son, Jesus, who will undo all of this and make all things right. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Okay. Oh, that's sad. I'm sorry, Marjorie. That's... No, I don't know. No, okay. Okay, let's get into it. Philadelphia, yeah? We didn't finish this, I don't think, in this class either. Okay. Did you know where we stopped? Anyone know where we stopped in here? I think we all kind of stopped in the same place in each class. Do we?
Open door.
That's okay, great. Perfect. Thank you. Open door. Good. So let's do a quick review of Philadelphia. Remember that Jesus describes himself as the holy and true one. We'll revisit this again when we get to Laodicea, but he is the faithful witness to God. Remember we said you do not know God apart from Christ. So Christ is the faithful witness to God. He's the one who holds the key of David. That is, he is the Lord over the house of God. He's the one in charge of the whole show. He has the keys to the kingdom and all of that business. So that is who Jesus is. And we said there in Philadelphia, it was a major trade route. So Jesus says to them, I know your works, and behold, I've set an open door which no one is able to shut. And we said that could be sort of a twofold meaning there. One, it could mean because the Philadelphians are weak and overwhelmed and frustrated by all they've been enduring, Jesus is reminding them with great comfort, no one's going to shut the door to heaven to you. You are in. You can take comfort in that. At the same time, Jesus could also be referring to the fact that those open doors there in Philadelphia would have reminded people, being a major trade route, would have reminded people of going out, leaving the gates of the city to go do trade. And so Jesus is reminding the church, you know, you are weak. However, you still have the call to go out and proclaim the gospel. And I'm not shutting the door. I'm keeping that open so you guys can continue to go out and preach the good news. So perhaps both of those sorts of things are going on there. But notice this again with Philadelphia. There is no significant rebuke. There's no harsh word from Jesus here. We will see that. We saw that in Sardis, and we'll see it even more so in Laodicea. But here, and scattered throughout the other ones, but this is the one letter where there is no real significant condemnation. I have this against you or anything like that. Make sense? Okay, good. So that's kind of where we're at. But the Philadelphians have not denied the name of Christ. So they got that going for them. They're doing well. Could somebody then read for us the rest of the Philadelphian letter? If you could read, let's go ahead and do verse 8 through 13, I believe. Yeah, 8 through 13. Thank you, Ron.
I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews, and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved thee. Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out. And I will write upon him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches.
Okay, thank you very much. You know, I haven't noticed this yet, and I feel foolish. When we ask each week, what does Jesus know? At five of the seven letters, Jesus says, I know your works. Smyrna and Pergamum, he says, I know your tribulation and your poverty. And in Pergamum, he says, I know where you dwell. It's a curious thing. I know he's, but this constant refrain of, I know your works. I don't know how much I want to dwell on it, but suffice it to say, Jesus is present. There is the knowledge of what is going on there. Jesus has an intimate knowledge of what is taking place in his churches. It's kind of an interesting, I just hadn't really noticed it until now, so I thought I'd bring it up. There you go. All right, so behold, I will make those who are a synagogue of Satan, who say they are Jews but are not, who say they are Jews and are not but lie, behold, I will make them come and bow down before your feet, and they will learn that I have loved you. We talked about this at length. I don't want to spend too much time on this, but remember the distinction when we use the word Jews. Jew doesn't always mean the same thing. There's two significant meanings for Jew. The first one is those who are of Jewish ethnicity, we'd say that. And then there's those who are of the Jewish faith. Those two things are not equal. Just because you were born in the Jewish ethnicity does not mean you are of the Jewish faith. You can be born of the Jewish ethnicity and be a part of the Christian faith. Take, for example, Peter, James, John, Paul, the apostles. Consider for a second that our Lord is Jewish, you know, those sorts of things. So those are things to keep in mind. What does it mean then to say that these particular people who are saying they are Jews and are not, what is Jesus getting at there with them? Why are they not Jews though they claim to be? And incidentally, just real briefly, what would be more useful, and our Old Testament doesn't do a very good job of this, some of them might, Jews would be better translated because in our minds, I didn't say this morning and I meant to, because in our minds we say Jew and we equate that with the religion, it would be more appropriate to translate the word Jew in the New Testament as Judahite. That is someone from Judah, right? So if you're from the tribe of Dan, you were called a Danite. If you're from Israel, the northern kingdom, you were considered an Israelite. If you're from Judah, you are a Jew. So it would be better to say a Judahite. Does that make sense? So you're associating it with the location and not the religion. That would be a helpful distinction for us. Go ahead, Tom.
I have a question.
Yes.
The Jewish people pass heritage through the mother.
Okay.
As I understand it.
Yeah.
And yet, in the Bible, it seems to pass it through the father. It's the son of David.
Yeah.
So when you say ethnicity, are you referring to the way they call it now, which is the mother produces the line, not the father, which I find very strange.
It's like there was a switch made someplace along the line, because was always passed through the Father in the Old Testament.
Yeah, well, I don't...
The Bible study was all the Father's.
I'm not sure... Now, help me with that. Luke's chronology... Luke or Matthew, one of them seems to go down to Mary, and the other one goes to Joseph. Matthew goes to Joseph, Luke goes to Mary. Matthew's the more Jewish of the Gospels.
But Luke is not Jewish.
Right, he's the Gentile, so that's curious. Yeah, I don't know how to answer that question. That was not even in my head, if that helps. Because I didn't.
Until you just said that.
Yeah. The idea there is simply they are of Jewish heritage, mother or father. Yeah. So people who are of that ethnic grouping, the Jews. I work at my daughter at her school, her library on Wednesdays, and the librarian told me today that her daughter. They had neighbors who were Jewish, and they would always have this family over for festivals and Passover and all these sorts of things. And so their daughter just loved it so much because the food was so great. You know, they go and eat all this great food. She started telling people that she was half Jewish because she spent so much time eating over there. I thought that was terrific.
And she really was.
No, she's not. No. So, just make sure we have that distinction in mind. Now, again, getting back to this, why is Jesus calling them a synagogue of Satan, saying they claim to be Jews but are not? What makes them not, though they claim to be?
They aren't worshiping as Jews, I take it.
Why? What would, if they were truly Jews, what would they be worshiping? Who would they be worshiping?
God.
Specifically?
Christ.
Christ.
Yes.
Right.
Well, true Jews would worship Christ.
Yes, because if they believe the Old Testament, they'd look to Christ. So what's happening here is, remember, in Jesus, this is Jesus' point in John's Gospel, that if you believed Abraham, if you listened to Abraham, you would believe me. If you listen to Moses, you'd be listening to me. The law and the prophets all point to him. So if you are truly a Jew in the religious sense, this is even where our language gets a little confused. Think of it this way. If you truly are one of the people of God, derived from the Old Testament, descending from the Old Testament, people of God, you would be looking for Christ and believing in Christ. Since you are not doing that, Jesus says, they are not of the people of God. They are of the people of Satan. Remember, there's no middle ground in the New Testament. As much as we'd like to do that, you're either on Jesus' team or you're not. Does that make sense? Go ahead.
So theoretically, the Gentiles were the official Jews.
You might say it this way. Not the Gentiles, but those who believe in Christ. Jew and Gentile alike are Israel, the new Israel, you might say.
Right.
That does not mean we get a plot of land in the Middle East, just so we're clear on this. But in terms of being the people of God, we are the true Israel.
The Gentiles.
Gentiles and Jews who believe in Christ.
Right.
So Jesus is sort of obliterating the ethnic distinctions. So in Ephesians 2, he's going to say there was a wall of separate. Paul's going to say there's a wall of separation between Jew and Gentile. That wall has been destroyed by the blood of Christ because his blood is for Jew and Gentile. There is no distinction. All of Romans, he does this in Romans 2, but Romans is masterful. Romans 1, he goes through all the Gentile sins. Now, here's all the problems with the Gentiles. And then in Romans 2, he says, oh, but the Jews think they're so much better. And then in Romans 3, he says, and you are all toast. You guys are all wrong because you don't have faith. Everyone who doesn't have faith in Christ is wrong. So Christ has come for both and made one. I mean, Paul is just brilliant. Someone had a hand. Yeah. Jack.
I don't know if anybody remembers it, and I think it was radio, not television, and yet I have a picture in my mind of these two individuals, but there was a show called The God Squad.
The God Squad?
It was a priest, I believe, and a rabbi.
And they walked into a bar.
Just the two of this summer.
Uh-huh.
How long ago was this?
Probably at least 15 years.
Oh, that's not too bad.
12, 15, something like that. But anyway, people would call in and ask them questions as they do with the Jesus Show on KFI in the morning, something similar to that. But they were more doctrinaire type of questions as opposed to life questions. And but what was fascinating about it was the subject, you know, you mentioned, Tom, the lineage through the female, and that's what I always understood. But people would call in, and either the priest would answer or the rabbi would answer, and then they would talk together and either agree or partially agree or disagree. But it was always in an academic setting, and it was very educational. Educational, I don't remember that.
The lineage through the female, Tom is talking about? What are you talking about?
I believe in Judaism that's the mother that counts for your lineage, that you back up through the female.
So when you're doing the family tree, it's the mother's side, not the father's side.
That determines whether or not you're Jewish.
That's certainly true now.
And I'm not sure the family tree is affected by that. The genealogy, I think it's the religiosity as opposed to the genealogy.
Oh, I see. Yeah. Okay.
Anyway. But that was a good show. Oh, my point, though. My point was...
Believe me, I know how it goes, Jack. Yeah.
We're making these comparisons between different synods in the Lutheran Church and then with other Christian churches and with other pseudo-Christian or non-cults, Jehovah's Witnesses or the Mormons. But we really haven't done that with the Jews. And your comments about the way the Jews should believe, which is what we believe, and the way they do believe, is a fascinating, it's a total another subject. It's not the Bible per se. I guess it is.
Yeah.
But I don't know if there's ever a way to do that, to have even a Bible study.
Yeah, a comparative religion study. It might be useful at some point. We will get there, and I'll make this promise now, because I know you'll forget by the time we do the end of Revelation. No one will remember anything I've said at this point.
Don't be too sure.
Yeah.
Some of us may not live to get to.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, that's a great point.
Yeah, so
we may be raptured out. You know, then I'll be the only one showing up and be like, oh man, was I wrong? The big thing, though, between us and Judaism is, at this point, Judaism is a fascinating religion at this point in history because, properly speaking, you cannot have that religion without the temple. Judaism, what Jesus encounters in the New Testament in the Sadducees is almost entirely a temple-based religion. Similar with the Pharisees, but the Pharisees at this point in the New Testament era, in Jesus' day, have begun to put more emphasis on the Torah, which predates the temple, right? For the Sadducees, religion is almost all temple-based. These are the two major groups. The temple's destroyed in AD 70. Guess who goes away? Sadducean Judaism.
Sadducees.
Yeah, they're gone. You just don't have them anymore because you don't have a temple.
And the Essenes.
And the Essenes, too. The Essenes are... an interesting sect. The Essenes think all of Judaism at this point in the New Testament era is whack, because I can't think of a better word at this point in the evening, is apostate, and they're the only ones who are right, so they go and they run off. I mean, that, you know, this happens to Christianity all the time.
Sort of,
yeah. But the Orthodox today, I'll never forget, I was in some bookstore, and I saw some book on the Pharisees written by a Jewish guy, just praising them for their obedience and their ability to adhere to the law. And when we talk in our classes about the problems of how they would build fences around the law to prevent people from committing certain acts, and you know, they would have all these Sabbath rules that Jesus is breaking all the time and all of this stuff, these rabbis were saying the Pharisees were actually nailing it at that point. They were absolutely right in what they were doing, and we need to get back to Pharisaical Judaism. Which, you know, for Christians to hear that is to say, You want what? Get back to Pharisaical. There's nothing worse than being a Pharisee. But for them, when your whole religion is based on the law, and I think we can all agree, at least we should all agree, that there's no better description of the law than, say, the Ten Commandments or Torah-based stuff. They're saying, and they'll say this now, because there's no temple, the sacrifice which atones for our sins is our good works. Then we need to get back to what the Pharisees were doing, because that's exactly how they were operating. So it's a very curious thing. At the end of the day, the big hang-up, and this is always the big hang-up with us and every other religion, is what do you say about the resurrection of Christ? Is he divine? And did he rise? If you'd say no to those two questions, then you're not on Christ's team. And you're in the wrong team. And that's not to say we should now start wars and throw them in jail and all that other nonsense that's gone on throughout history, but it is to say we cannot say that they are faithfully believing the Word of God. Go ahead, Tom.
Maybe you can help me clean up another... Yeah, you pick up stuff along the way. But I was under the impression that what they call it now is a rabbinical mm-hmm. law as opposed to a Pharisaic law. That what the Jews are following now is a rabbinical law.
Sure.
Which means they don't have sacrifice. They can't have sacrifice.
Right.
They don't have temple.
There's no temple.
So they got to follow some other. But it's just as valid as far as they're concerned. Mm-hmm. Is that incorrect?
No, that's correct. Yeah, yeah. When I say Pharisaical, I'm not saying that they are of the school of the Pharisees, but that they look back on the Pharisees' view of the law and saying, the rabbis, I believe, now I have to do my work on this, but the rabbis today would say, those guys were on the right track. That's who, if we look back through our history, those are the people we want to look to. The Sadducees, and now you still have this sort of thing in Judaism because you have the different kinds of Jews. So you have the, what is the thing called? The Orthodox Jews. And then you have the more progressive ones.
Conservatives.
Yeah, it's not conservative.
Reform.
There we are. Thank you. Reform Jews, Hasidic Jews, all of these things. So you've got, you can kind of say you have the Missouri Synod Jews and the Wisconsin Synod Jews and the ELC. I mean, it's kind of very similar to what we've got going on, where some are more capitulating to the culture and others are fighting back against it. And all that kind of stuff. So, I mean, it's very interesting the correlations that arise in those things. But I would say that in rabbinic Judaism, my guess, and this is a huge guess, but my guess is the rabbis would say we can learn a great deal from the same rabbis that you have at the beginning of the AD era or whatever. So Hillel and Gamaliel and all these people are actually people to look to. And, this is probably true. If you ever go on a college campus, they have the Hillel House, which is the Jewish club on campus. And Hillel was a great rabbi who predates Jesus just by a little bit, you know. So those are names that are still very significant. So yeah, 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 yeah.
It seems like a lot of the modern day Judaism came out of the Talmud, though.
Sure.
Which was rabbinic in its development.
I would think so. I think also that the Talmud is rather significant, I believe, in the New Testament era as well. What the Talmud is this is great. The Talmud is rabbis arguing. So here's what the law says. You cannot cook a goat in its mother's milk. Very catechetical. What does this mean? Right? And then you have one rabbi say this, one rabbi say that, and then each sort of the schools of rabbis will fall on the side of Hillel or Gamaliel or whoever rabbi speaks in there, and then those are still points of discussion. So you can actually see, this is just how awful the academy always is. You can see how this becomes this sort of Gamaliel says this, Hillel says this. Now we have our two schools, and within those schools, the Hillelites are arguing about what Hillel says, and the Gamalielites are going to argue about what Gamaliel says, and then from there you have your different teachers who go off and do their different schools. So by the time, you have all these rules and basis of operating, and the legalism just abounds. Thank goodness that doesn't happen in Lutheran circles.
Is that why you see a group of rabbis that always arguing?
Yeah. Well, no, that's right.
It's true.
And it's part of the culture, and it's not a... It's an argument in the best possible way. It's an argument of respect and love for the same thing. It's not a sort of Fox versus MSNBC kind of thing.
I think they would call it an academic discussion.
An academic discussion, yeah. And
And how come they always wear the hats and they always got beards?
So, because laws. So, in the Old Testament, it was you weren't to shave if you were a priest, especially, you were not to shave your face, and certain kinds of priests were to grow their hair long and all kinds of stuff like that. And the hats all represent stuff. I always forget what it all is.
Yarmulke.
Well, because I think this is a symbol of reverence, right? You go into a worship, you go into the synagogue, or into the temple, I think it's a synagogue, you're going to the synagogue, and you're going to hear the word of God. And it's a symbol of submission that I'm now beneath something else. And those the Jews who will wear their... I just gave you the name. Yeah, this is where I'm all the time, is to say, I'm operating in this way, always under the authority of God. Same with my ring, right? I'm always operating under the authority of Steph, no matter where I am. It's kind of one of those sorts of things. So she would approve of that statement. So it's a curious thing.
Let's move on.
Yeah, but no, that's a great question. And I need to learn more about it, Jack. We've done classes even like specifically on Islam, but Judaism would be fascinating, especially for that reason that they don't have a temple. So how do they exist? This is a very curious question. I bet I could go to a local synagogue and ask them. They'd be willing to talk to me. Yeah.
As long as we're on the topic and it's completely off,
it's not. There's a whole verse that uses the word Jew, so I'm allowed. We're allowed to do what we're doing. Yeah.
The little box on their head.
Yep.
That you see on TV.
Uh huh. Right,
that carries a mitzvah, right?
Yep.
It's a prayer.
Yep. It's a.
I've never seen that, a box on the roof.
Yeah, so...
Yeah, they have a band, and there's a little box.
Box right there. So there's a verse that says, in Deuteronomy, that says, teach these words to your children, bind them on your foreheads and on your wrists. And so they take it so very literally that they put a box with the mitzvah. I think it's actually the great Shema. Now, I could be wrong. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is the Lord is one. And they put that box on their head, and then they tie... bands around their arm with prayers on them, and then they sit and they go into their worship center and they pray. If you ever look at the Wailing Wall, they'll typically have those things. I did when I was doing party delivery. I went to a I don't think it was a temple. I think it was a school. It was near the local synagogue and it was a school. And there's a whole bunch of guys upstairs in the sanctuary. It looked like an old church in the sanctuary doing this. So I went downstairs to pick up some chairs and I said to a guy who looked like he knew what he was doing, at least he had to sign my papers, so I knew something that he was in charge. And I said, what are they doing upstairs? Explain this to me. I'm sort of a student of these things. I'm curious. And this guy, he was pumped to even get to talk about it. Oh, these are the boxes. And I mean, it was just, he teed off for 15 minutes explaining this stuff. It was fascinating.
And the people put them on their front door.
Yeah, and buy them over your doorposts and on your fence posts. I mean, it's... And teach them to your children when you wake up in the morning, when you go to bed at night.
It's a symbol of they're doing works.
No, I mean, this is one of those things where
it's the Old Testament.
It is. But this is one of those things where, I mean, if you're putting your hope in that, it's not okay. But I'm becoming more and more one of these guys who sees...
Symbolism
as being very important and significant, so that... We're not going to boast in how. What does Jesus say? You like to have your phylacteries drag across the ground. They have those ropes that are reminders of prayer shawls or something like this, and they were called phylacteries, and they would drag across the ground. And Jesus says, "Oh, look at you, big phylacteries! Like, stop showing off." And I agree with that, but there's something to be said for a ritual that actually helps focus you on the prayer. So they're not forgetting that prayer. They can't. It's bound on their head, literally. And so it's a reminder. All right, fine. I'm not going to say, you know, we need to do that. But it's also, I mean, our contemporary way of doing this might be if you want to memorize a Bible verse and pray through it, write it down, put it in your pocket. Every time you reach in there, there's your memory verse for the day. You know, I mean, it's nothing more than a practical thing. They're just doing it in a way that the Bible describes, so it's kind of significant. I like it to that extent.
I even like the idea. One thing I admire about the Muslims is that they do stop and pray. Like the other day, I was at the grocery store, and this lady got a rug out, and she's next to her car, praying because it was 3 o'clock.
Yeah. Yeah, there's
they stop wherever they are and they pray.
It's time to do it. There's a ritualism to it. That's not entirely bad. It can always delve into legalism, but everything else can.
But five times a day, I believe.
Yeah, that's right for them.
And however, we're reading a lot about this ISIS organization and like organizations, Al-Qaeda, somewhat like it. But, I mean, they're literally putting people, Muslims, to death who have not prayed five times a day.
See, that's where you may say we're dipping into the legalism at this point, the violent, awful, fundamentalistic legalism, which is not what this is intended for. Oh, and wicked. I would go maybe that far. But this idea of setting up ritual times, the church has done this for years in the monastic movement, where you have five times throughout the day or seven times throughout the day where you pray. You'll even look in our hymnals and you have the order of matins, of vespers, of compline. Those are titles for services that took place at different parts of the day. So the matin service, O Lord, open my lips and my mouth will declare your praise. It's a morning prayer. Vespers, we come to the close of the day, all this kind of stuff. They're beautiful, beautiful services. There's no need to legalize them and say, if you're truly in, this is what you must do. In other words, that's where the Muslims go a little far. But to run to the other extreme, which we're so ready to do, and say, so, you know, pray when you feel like it. Like, no, wait, there's actually some value to this, you know? Because I'm willing to bet the person who says, well, I just pray when I feel like it, doesn't actually pray nearly as much as the person who has the ritual set up, see? So it's some stuff we're thinking about. I don't know. Okay, good. Anything else on that?
That passage from Deuteronomy. Sixth chapter, beginning with the fourth verse.
Okay.
If anybody wants to read it.
Why not?
Oh, you want
to? Yeah, go for it. I mean, just read it for us so we understand. We get it right.
It starts this way. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates.
Yeah. And so, I mean, this is, and the words there that they're specifically referring to, I think at least at this point, is the great Shema, Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one, which is the Old Testament equivalent of the Apostles' Creed. This is
so
the confession of faith. Moses in
Moses.
Deuteronomy.
It's Deuteronomy.
Yeah.
Deuteronomy chapter 6.
And then the other one is love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And so those are the two things that they would pray through and think about, and it's pretty cool. Okay. This is ecumenical as I'll ever get for you. Okay.
What did all that pertain to what we're talking about?
Because the question was, what's the problem with the synagogue of Satan, with people who claim to be Jews and are not? The issue is that they are worshiping something besides Christ. And if you're not worshiping God in Christ, you're not truly worshiping God. And then Moses, no, not Moses, the opposite of Moses, Jesus goes on to say this to them, that they will come and I will make them bow down before your feet and they will learn that I have loved you. Now this comes from my... don't like working from my phone, I'm sorry. Somewhere in the Old Testament. Isaiah 45 and Isaiah 60. We're not gonna go there because I want to get through two letters actually tonight. But Isaiah 45 and 60, there is the picture of all the Gentiles coming into Israel and bowing down and acknowledging that Yahweh is the one true God. And bowing, in a sense, before the people of Israel, saying, your God is the true God. Think of Jonah, right? And Jonah's on the boat, and all the people are praying to their gods to make the waves stop, and it doesn't work. And Jonah comes upstairs and says, you know what? I really don't want to go to Nineveh, so I'm just going to jump in the ocean and die to get out of this thing. And he does, and as soon as he does, the sea is silenced. And the Gentiles on the boat all start worshiping God, right? This is the idea. Now, and acknowledging that Jonah's God is the one true God, something like this. Here, what's shocking about what Jesus does is he's saying, you dear church in Philadelphia, full of both Jews and Gentiles, the Jews themselves will come and bow down before you, acknowledging you, recognizing that I have loved you. Now, the Jews in Jesus' day would have appropriated those Isaiah verses to themselves. Jesus appropriates them to the church, Jew and Gentile, who have faith in Christ Jesus. Does that make sense? So the commentary I'm working with says this can work in one of two ways. This bowing down and acknowledging that Christ has loved his church will either happen on the day of judgment, where you hear of every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of the Father, or more optimistically, this would happen at the conversion of the Jews. Jews who say, wait a minute. Oh, Jesus was the Messiah. The Gentiles are included. Praise be to God. And they join in and they become a part of the family, something like this. So either of those might be the fulfillment of what is said right there. We do get that in Romans 9, 10, and 11. In one of those sections, it talks about Jews coming back in, going out and coming back in. And that does happen throughout the history of the church. It's a constant pattern. Go ahead.
Well, once the Jews come back to Christ, then there's no difference between us as Gentiles and the Jews.
Right.
We're all believers in Christ.
Right. Though I will finish your thought. Go ahead.
Well, then what I would go on to say is that at the judgment, we as believers are going to be supposedly judging with Christ, mm-hmm. and all his enemies will be under his feet.
Right.
So the symbology then is that they will also be under our feet while we're sitting alongside.
Sure, something along those lines. That's right. Yeah, that's right. Now, we can say this, that the Jews have something on us Gentiles. And this is always worth remembering, Missouri Synod Church, who come from Germans who weren't Jews. It's worth remembering. Well, it's not worth remembering because I completely forgot what I was going to say. How's about that? It's a long day. Oh, yeah. That the Gentiles are the ones who have been grafted in. That we weren't here initially. So Paul will talk this way in Romans where he'll say, you know, what advantage do the Jews have? They got like every advantage. Because they have Moses and the prophets and the promises and all of this stuff was through them. That's actually the people through whom the Messiah was born. They've got everything up on us. It's an actual terrifying and devastating tragedy that many of them don't believe. This is not good because they have everything in their system that is pointing to the coming of Christ, and many of them have rejected. So they do actually have a leg up on us in that way. But when it comes to the standing before the throne of God, the end times judgment, so to speak, there's neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male or female, all are one in Christ Jesus. Baptismal language there, see. So, very interesting stuff. Okay, moving on. Because you, dear Philadelphians, have kept my word about patient endurance, we can assume have been suffering on some level, perhaps at the hands of the Jews who are attacking them, I will keep you from the hour of trial that is coming on the whole world. To try those who dwell on earth. I am coming soon. Hold fast to what I have so no one may seize your crown. Okay, just real briefly, I mentioned this at the very beginning of the class. It's worth visiting just real quickly. We said that there's a bad interpretation of these letters that views each of the letters not as literal letters to literal churches, but each letter represents an era of church history. So the letter to Ephesus represents the first however long of church history, and then it just kind of goes through. And some folks of the left behind ilk will say that Philadelphia represents the church that will be on earth at the time of the rapture. And the rapture will come, and the reason Philadelphia represents this is because Jesus promises you will not have to endure the tribulation that's about to come. In other words, this is symbolically telling the rest of the church who's alive at that time, Christ is going to suck you out of the earth before the tribulation comes. And that's how they read these verses, that these are prophesying a sort of rapture. This is an allusion to the rapture. So it's not speaking directly to the Philadelphia church, but it's saying to the Philadelphia church sort of symbolically, thank you, Ron, I'll take a little bit more. because clearly I've had enough. thank you. The Philadelphia church, that they won't have to go through it, is really speaking to the church at the time of the rapture. That works if you impose that system on the text. You do not draw that from the text. From the text, what you learn is that Christ isn't going to make Philadelphia go through some hardship here coming soon. And he has the right to do that. Does that make sense? Okay. The rapture, if we could just spend 2 minutes on that, is a doctrine that arises from a teacher named John Nelson Darby, who is around in the late 19th century, I think, mid to late 19th century. He's I believe a Scottish Presbyterian, or he's at least a part of some fairly legalistic Scottish group, and is kicked out for extreme legalism, I think, and also for false teaching on the history of the world. Darby believed you could break the Bible up, and thus world history up, into seven dispensations, seven eras or dispensations, hence the term dispensationalism. And what he said was, right now the church is the sixth era or dispensation of history, and once Christ is done with the church era, he will rapture the church out of the world, and he will start the seventh era, which is the millennial reign of Christ on earth. And we'll get there in a very long time, towards the end of Revelation. So he's going to take those 1,000 years very literally. This became a very influential teaching here in America under Scofield, the Scofield Reference Bible, I think is the name of it.
Scofield and Ryrie.
Ryrie, yeah. Ryrie's, I think, still alive. I read his book on dispensationalism. You can borrow it if you want. There's a lot of angry notes in it. Scofield got Darby's stuff, brought it to America, put it into a study Bible, and people started reading it, and it started to gain some influence. It's only recently that it's become wildly popular, but it's a very much escapist theology that says the church will not have to endure tribulation. Yes?
Why then the hour of trial has already begun for Christians?
Suffering. Under tyrants, yep.
Yeah.
What, his explanation of that?
Well, yeah.
His explanation of that would be, well, that's bad, but it's not the tribulation. It's not as bad as it will be for those 7 years of tribulation.
No, because they're being persecuted.
Yeah, he says that persecution is going to pale in comparison to what's going to take place later on. So, hey, suffering Christian, it's not that bad. Could be the tribulation.
Well,
exactly, right? You're like, all right, come on. So, no, I agree. And this is where, if that's really the teaching, you sort of have to put yourself in the first century context and say, really, really? Do you think that's the message of the New Testament? Don't worry, you might get sucked out of the earth before it gets really bad. It doesn't get much worse than burnt at the stake, and if that's not working, we're going to chop your head off. Crucified upside down stuff, you know. So, you know, I'm on the same page with you. This is what we Lutherans like to call a theology of glory, that seeks to avoid suffering in the cross. We don't think that's... and by the cross, I don't mean the cross of Jesus. I mean the take up your cross and follow me cross. We're very hesitant for this kind of thinking.
The ones that are doing that, their time is yet to come.
What do you mean? Yeah, that there will be a day of reckoning. We might say a day of judgment for them. Yes, that's right. And that's what we see throughout. We'll see that especially as we get through Revelation. Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, there's a whole school of thought that believes that very thing happened during Domitian's.
Yeah, well, then there's a group called the...
Right?
Oh.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You get to learn all these great terms. There's a group called the Preterists. Preterists. Preterism. I'll get you on it next week. Don't worry, Esther. The Preterists. And the Preterists believe everything that's prophesied to happen in the New Testament happened already in AD 70. except for the second coming. Although there's some preterists who are nuts, but they're not around anymore, who said, oh yeah, it happened then too. But there's the preterists that everything that's prophesied, so to speak, in the New Testament already took place. I tend to sympathize more with preterists. I think they're really on to some things. I think a lot of Revelation is talking about first century stuff. And that's where they're coming from too. However, I also think not only is it talking about first century stuff, but it's also describing what the church can expect to endure until Christ comes again. So when you see them prophesying about Caesar doing something terrible to the church, don't expect that kind of treatment from the state to go away. It will continue till Christ comes again. But preterists just sort of say, nope, this stuff is just time-bound to the first century. There's no real need to try and apply it, you know. But that's a really hard line to take. Though where I've really begun to think they're onto something is the way they read Mark 13 and Matthew 25, the end of the world stuff there, where we all think Jesus is talking about the destruction of the world. Like he says, brother will turn on brother, and there will be persecution and wars and rumors of wars and all that. I think there he's actually talking about the destruction of the temple. Then I would take the preterist tack on that route, and then he answers the second coming question later on in the text. But that's an interesting one. But it's not, it's the opposite of the premillennial group or the dispensationalist group, which suggests everything's happening in the future. Yeah. I'd say the best place to put your money, because they do, I'm sure you can bet on these things in Vegas, but I'd say the best place to put your money is on Jesus, who says, I'm coming again, and say, yep, we'll go with that. All right. So the beauty, if you ever read the Lutheran Confessions, just how very little we say about any of this stuff. What does the Lutheran Church believe about the second coming of Christ? It's going to happen. Like, that's it. You know, that's probably what it should say. And, yeah, it'll happen. Yeah.
But who's going to pay off on that bet? Think about that one. Nuts.
Yeah. I need to go get my money back. Okay.
It's a blue chip.
It's a blue chip. All right. Okay, so there you go. So just some stuff to keep in mind there. The big rapture verses are this one, and then there's the Thessalonians text, which we looked at a few weeks ago, that says we will be caught up in the air. And that's actually where they get the word rapture, because the word for caught up in Latin is rapture or something like that. So you'll be caught up in the air to greet Jesus. We just tend to think it's more like a Palm Sunday caught up, that they go out of the city to meet him and welcome him in. That's kind of what we think is going on there. The other one is those strange verses in Matthew where it says one will be working in the field, one will be taken, one will be left, just as in the days of Noah. And there's kind of two ways to read that. I mean, some people say those who were taken, we did this morning. Who was taken in the days of Noah? And who was left? Who was left behind in the days of Noah?
Moses and his family.
No.
Noah and his family.
Yeah. Noah and his family. But the dispensationalist read of that is the bad people were left behind, and Noah and his family were taken up. They were rescued, caught up out of the tribulation. And I'm actually not quite sure which is the better read of that text. I'm certainly not taking the dispensationalist read, but I tend to lean towards that one, that it's Noah and his family who are left behind to start things over.
You're talking about generalizing.
What do you mean?
The rest of the population on earth.
It wasn't that day, yeah. Everybody was out except for Noah and his family.
But even innocent people.
Well, that's the issue. None were innocent. No one was off the hook, yeah.
Even the Bushman out in Australia?
Even the Bushman out in Australia. No one's righteous. I don't know. It's, you know, but here's what you always got to remember with that. God actually knows what he's doing when he's judging somebody. And I'm not saying that sarcastically. I'm being very serious. If God's going to condemn someone to hell, he knows why he's doing it. If God's going to subject someone to the flood, it's not arbitrary.
Or he could have taken them.
He could have, or he could have destroyed them. Yeah. It's his call. So that's on him, and we have to trust that he knows what he's doing with that.
Right.
Because that's always the question, well, what about those poor innocent people? There's actually not one person like that. There's no such thing as a poor innocent person. Now, there's the real issue is what about the person who's never heard? Now, that's a different question. Is it fair for God to, the person who never had a chance to hear the gospel, is it fair for God to condemn them? He will judge them rightly based on what they've done.
Paul says what can be known about God is plainly written.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. And when it comes to those election issues, Paul starts talking about it in Romans 9 through 11, and in Romans 11 he finally goes, he kind of gets to a point and he goes, oh, the mysteries of God. Who can fathom then? He's like, I got to get out of this conversation somehow, you know.
That's a good question. Was that before the dinosaur or after the dinosaur?
Yep. What's that? Someone else had a question. I don't know.
Seriously. Because we know the dinosaurs were here.
Sure. And they were probably there that first week, created with Adam and Eve, and Adam probably named them. Though he probably didn't say Tyrannosaurus Rex because he didn't know Latin. but it's just probably worth noting.
He's a lion.
He called him lion. Yeah, that's right. All right. There was another hand. If the dinosaurs were created the same time as all the other animals, I think that's easy. It's okay to say that. Okay. But Jesus does say, I mean, it is very interesting here, for at least the Philadelphian church, they will not have to endure some terrible trial that's going to come upon the earth. I think it's interesting that Ron's, the old King James there, translates that temptation. You will not have to undergo this temptation. That's a curious thing. But the hour of trial that's coming, the Philadelphia church will be protected from that. That does not mean they will not have to face some of it. That doesn't mean they're going to have to not face hardship, but they will be kept through it. They will not have to undergo it in a particular way that the other churches might. And then it's just one promise after another for them. I'm coming soon, which we'll see again at the end of the book. This is the ultimate promise given to the church. I am coming soon, though he and you and I have a different definition of soon. He will come soon. Hold fast to what you have so no one may seize your crown. The one who conquers, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and never shall he go out of it. I will write on him the name of my God, the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which will come down from my God out of heaven, and my own new name. Here we again have this name stuff. Now notice how the name is on the pillar in the temple. I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God. The idea of the pillar here is like an unshakable, unmovable pillar, which is significant in Philadelphia, because in Philadelphia it's like living on the San Andreas Fault, right? And so it's a whole lot of shaking going on. And so what's going on here is Jesus is saying, I'm going to set you up as a pillar that cannot be shaken, something firm that's not going to move. That gives some kind of assurance there, okay? Also, you'll never leave the temple. This is not like I'm locking you in here until you do something, right? It's the presence of God. Temple is presence of God in the Old Testament stuff. And so you will never leave the presence of God. And also note this, that this New Jerusalem, we've talked enough about the name, but the New Jerusalem coming down from heaven. This is always the direction, I guess we could say it this way. The direction of the gospel is always down. Christ coming down. God coming down. The coming to. It's never a movement up. We're never climbing Jacob's ladder. Even in the Jacob's ladder texts, it's the angels ascending and descending on the Son of Man who has come down, you know. And so the idea in all of this is that the gospel is God to us coming down, even to the very end, on the last day. When the second coming of Christ arrives, we're not going to have to climb up to meet him. I guess we'll be caught up to greet him if we're still alive and brought back to life. But the big movement of that day is Jesus descending, coming down. And this is always the way of the gospel.
Yeah, well, that has something to do with the way the curtain was torn.
Yeah, well, that's a curious thing. That's a great point there. That in the temple, when Christ dies, I forget which gospel it's in, but it's actually the point is made. The temple was torn in two from the top down. Who's tearing the temple?
God.
And why is the temple torn? I think we always think of it this way. So now we can access God. Now we can get in. Or better said, maybe because now God's getting out. See it? See that? God's coming out. Because it's the down coming towards you. And God's like, here I am. Look out, you know. And it's just this, the gospel is just coming out. There's no sacrifice necessary to get in there anymore. The sacrifice has been made. So the reconciliation has taken place. And God is now at peace with those who have faith in him. So the coming out, I think, is there. I've really begun to like this picture of the coming down. We don't have a ladder to God, but God descends to us. Even in prayer, and I think I mentioned this morning, with our prayers, we always think of us lifting our prayers up to God. And the Psalms will kind of talk this way, let my prayer rise before you as incense as the evening sacrifice. That's in one of those Latin services too. But think of Israel trapped in Egypt, and God says to Moses, I have heard the cries of my people. It's a very profound verse that we just skip over. That God, oh yeah, I know, so now I'm going to rescue him. No, God has heard the cries of his people, so that the thrust of prayer is not just words going up, but I like to think of it this way, the Holy Spirit grabbing the Father's ear and pulling it down. So that the Spirit is the one lifting our prayers up and bringing God down to listen, something like this. Even then, it's the listening of God that's the main thing, not the faithful word of the prayer. See, so the emphasis is always on God coming.
It's the Spirit through each and every one of us, too.
The Spirit at work for us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For us, through us, praying to God.
Yes, correct. Good. Yeah.
Does that have anything to do with Jesus being angry with the Pharisees? Because they were hiding them themselves, hiding the people from God, in effect, by usurping what God was and who God was to them. The Pharisees were... you were talking earlier about the Pharisaic way. Was some author was looking at that as maybe the way the Jews should be looked at, people of Israel should be looked at from a religious point of view. But
well, don't you have to remember at that time, though, the Pharisees heard that the Messiah was born, that a king was born. That's why they went out and they were looking to kill
the
firstborn.
That's Herod. That's not the Pharisees. That's the king, the phony king of England, the phony king of Jerusalem. Yeah, no, you're on the right track there, Jack. So with the Pharisees, it was, if we are going to be right before God, we've got to obey the law. But boy, we do so many things that get us close to breaking that law. We need to set up a fence around the law so that we can't even get to the law to break it.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to get at.
Yeah, and so that righteousness...
It's a fine line, I know.
Yeah, so no, that you're on the exact right track. The righteousness before God was found in faith and works. We might say it that way. It's a very big debate right now, and if that's really the way the Pharisees thought. But it certainly is now that righteousness before God is by the sacrifice of my works, my good works. And it's just crass, my good works make me right before God. It's the climbing of the ladder. It's the look what I'm presenting to you. This Sunday, this is great. We're going to do Matthew 25. And Matthew 25 is the sheep and the goats, the judgment of the sheep and the goats. And Jesus says, when I was hungry, you gave me something to eat. When I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. And they say, when did we ever do this, Lord? And he says, well, you did it for the least of these. You did it for me. And we always read those passages and we kind of go, oh, look, these are the great works we're doing for Jesus. That's not in the text at all. In fact, no one's presented a single work to Jesus in that text. In that text, they all go, well, when did we do that? They're not even aware of it. And no one presents anything to Jesus. Jesus is the one coming and saying, oh, I'm calling that good. See? So it's a very interesting thing that even the works are given a sort of gospel word from Christ. I accept that work. I love it. It was like you did it for me. Wow. Huh. All that time I thought I was just letting the dog out, you know? I mean, who knew that it was such a good thing? So it's always that this idea that our works matter but not towards salvation. They're always a product of that. It's not an upward movement that we go on, we're climbing the morality ladder on the way up into heaven. Our sanctification is increasing, so we're getting closer and closer. It's God giving gifts. Make sense? Okay.
Is Philadelphia the number one church here in the book of Revelation?
Why do you ask that question? I mean, I'm not...
Because prior to Philadelphia, the Lord kind of admonishes.
Yeah. I wouldn't say it's the number one church. I would say it's the most beaten up church. And the Lord, you can think of, the Lord quotes Isaiah and says, a smoldering wick he will not, or the Gospels quote Isaiah about Jesus saying, a smoldering wick he will not put out, and a bruised reed he will not break. We can think of Philadelphia perhaps as that bruised reed and smoldering wick. So the Lord's not coming with harsh words to them because he's not going to break them. He loves them too much. Okay? But there are those who need to be broken. And that's in our next book here. Let's get into it real quick. Laodicea. Nicely. I mean, you set that transition up very nicely for me, Ryan. Very good. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Letter to Laodicea. Laodicea, quick couple things here. Located on the Lycus Valley by the Lycus River in the southwestern part of Phrygia. Located on the juncture of two major trade routes. On this trade route, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea are all on the same trade route. So you can see this is the way the letter's getting there through these churches. Okay, Colossa is within 10 miles. You may recall at the end of the book of Colossians, Paul says, take the letter I've sent you and get it to the Laodiceans and make sure you read their letter too. Which is very interesting for people who always wondered, did Paul think what he was writing was the Bible? Yeah, probably so. And so he's making sure his letters are being read in all the churches. Kind of interesting thing. So Paul's probably the one who founded that church. Now I want you to listen to this. It's very quick here. Something significant about the local water supply. The Lycus River, which ran through the city, was described as turbid with white mud, nauseous and undrinkable. The neighboring city of Colossa to the east was watered by a cold mountain stream. Hierapolis, to the north, set on a natural hot spring, which was believed to have medicinal qualities, but Laodicea obtained its water through an aqueduct running from a hot spring located 5 miles to the south. The water was scalding hot when it entered the aqueduct, but it was filled with calcium, carbonate, and by the time the water traveled 5 miles down the system and arrived in the city, it was lukewarm and barely drinkable. It's a matter of record throughout the early history, Laodicea's growth and prosperity was hindered by its lack of drinking water, though as we'll see, it's still a pretty prosperous city, a situation with which every one of Laodicea's residents would have been familiar. Something just to keep in mind as we read through the letter on the church. Under the Roman Empire, this place became one of the wealthiest cities in Phrygia. Because of its all these industries, one was sheep, a great sheep industry, and they made very expensive wool clothing. They were known for, all right, Art, you're going to say it properly for me.
It's been a long day.
No, let Art do it. Let's see if Art does it.
I
what? What did they put on the eyes?
Ointment.
What was it called?
Salve.
What is it?
Salve. The L silent. Just think of saved.
Yeah. Silent Sav. L, that's not Sav. A thing. There's no such thing in the English language.
It's spelled S-A-L-V-E.
Yeah, so it's solve.
No, solve would be S-O-L. Excuse me.
But the L's not silent, see?
Sav.
Sav.
Sav, like a sav.
So, all right, so there was an eye ointment and an ear ointment that came from there. It was known for its healing. The ancient god Menkaru, the god of healing, was believed to be located in this place. As it became more Hellenized, that god's name got changed to Zeus. Rob Phillips pointed out for us this morning that Menkaru in the ancient world was probably associated with Baal. We all remember Baal, our big bad guy from the Old Testament. So that if you ever see pictures of Zeus by a bull, it's because the bull was Baal was sort of the idol Baal had bull-like qualities and all this kind of stuff, and Zeus is derived from that.
Is that the proper pronunciation? I always thought of it as ball.
Bale.
It's got two A's in it, right?
Yeah, so you want to say it's like a bay, ale. Bay, ale, bale. Yeah, so it's almost like two... Not consonants.
Syllables.
Syllables, there we are. Two syllables. But you say it so fast, it's bale. The emphasis is on the wrong syllable.
B-A-A-L.
B-A-A-L. All right. We would spell it B-A-L. Okay, we're done. All right. In the second century, it became a major place for the imperial cult, but that is not yet. Okay. Jesus says this. To the angel in the church of Laodicea write, the words of the Amen and the faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's creation. I know your works, you are neither cold nor hot. Would that you were either cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. You say, I am rich, I have prospered, I need nothing, not realizing that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked. Huh? I counsel you to buy from me gold refined by fire so that you may be rich and white garments. This is such a poor translation. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined by fire so that you may be rich, and also to buy white garments so that you may clothe yourself and the shame of your nakedness may not be seen, and also buy ointment to anoint your eyes so that you may see. Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline, so be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him and he with me. The one who conquers, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne, as I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Okay, the Amen. Amen is a Hebrew word. Who knows what Amen means? So be it, let it be so, yeah. It was a word used at the end of things to confirm the acceptance of something or attest to the truthfulness of a statement or action. When
said
you say...
Huh? Said and done.
Yeah, that's right. Said and done. Let it be so, let it be done. Yeah. So that when you say it at the end of the Lord's Prayer, you're saying, let it be so, let it be done. God, you will do this. Or you're not commanding him, but you're saying, trusting God, you will accomplish what I just prayed for. Notice that Jesus, when he speaks, very often, especially in John's gospel, will say, Amen, amen, I say to you, or truly, truly, I say to you. This is a very significant phrase used by Jesus, because in the Old Testament, when you have a word from God, the prophets would say, especially in Ron's Bible, thus saith the Lord. Or in your other Bible, God said it. I don't know what they would do in the Living Bible with that. I'm not sure. God said. But when Jesus says, truly, truly, I say to you, you'll notice there's no thus saith the Lord, because Jesus is saying, look, I'm the Amen on the subject. I'm the end. When I say it, it's everything those things have been building up to. I am the Lord, so I've said it. Let it be so, let it be done. You know, that's the idea. They're very significant passage to remind us that Jesus actually believed he was God. He doesn't appeal to God to speak. He just, truly, truly, I say to you. Jesus also, it's significant that he would say it at the beginning of his teachings and not at the end. In other words, this doesn't need to be built on. What I'm about to say to you is the last word on the subject. Okay. So that you kind of get that idea. So when Jesus is speaking here, he's saying, I'm about to speak to you truly. What I'm about to say to you is very significant. The faithful and true witness, we talked about that last week, but we should say this, that when you speak the truth, sometimes it hurts. So if Jesus is going to be the true witness, he's not going to let sinful people who are taking advantage of God and ignoring God off the hook. He's going to tell them where it's at. You guys are being boneheads. Wake up. He used that wake-up language specifically back in, was it Sardis? I think it was the last one. But again, here he's going to speak as the true one, the true witness to God, and here's truly what God thinks about what's going on here. It's not happy news. Okay, so he's not going to fudge things. And lastly, the beginning of God's creation. This is just worth noting. The word there in Greek is arche, and that in Greek can mean the source of. So Jesus, when he says he is the beginning of God's creation, he's saying that he is the source of God's creation, not the first thing God made. Jesus is not a creature. Though he becomes a creature in the incarnation, he is not a created thing. He is God. In the beginning, John says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus is the Word by which... Jesus is the Word, the mechanism, the thing by which God creates all things, whatever that means. Okay? All right.
What does your translation say about God's creation and describing Christ?
What's the verb? The beginning of God's creation. Oh. What does yours have?
The ruler.
Yeah, this is the other thing. Arche can also mean Lord and authority. So that it's probably... Now, the word is arche, which means beginning or source. But that also carries the same thing as the Lord of, the authority over. So he's the... How I have this here, hold on. It can also mean first and foremost. So he's the first and foremost over all creation. He's Lord over it. It has that has both those meanings there. So neither translation is wrong, but they do convey very different things. Yeah.
Is that the root word for archaic?
Yes. Yes, exactly right. Because archaic means ancient or that which other things are derived from, I think, ultimately. Yeah, yeah. Although that's not how we use archaic now, is it? Now it's out of date, is now what it means, yeah. So Jesus is the out-of-date one. Yeah, there you go.
Well, we just don't say that. I think I'll move.
He was cool before it was cool to be cool, you know, something like that. Yeah. Right. You also can think here of Jesus being the firstborn of the dead, that kind of language from... Firstborn is a very different meaning, but he's the first one to rise, and we all will rise like him. So he's the... You can think of it this way. He's... By virtue of his incarnation and resurrection, he is the first part of the new creation. He's the first one to be experiencing the new creation, the new heavens and new earth reality.
It kind of makes you wonder where the Father came from.
Nowhere. And neither did Jesus or the Holy Spirit. They came from nothing. No, you can't. It's eternity. Yeah, that's the whole point. Like, you can't wrap your head around that thing.
Well, science can't comprehend it either.
No, but, yeah, yeah. So, yeah, eternity is one of those things that's beyond our grasp.
It's constant energy.
Nope, no, 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 because God made that. You can't say, the question is, well, what made God? Well, no, no. You can't ask that question. Because what that does is it forces God underneath something. Yeah. So God is bound by... So think of the Trinity, for example. Can we explain the Trinity? No. It's not an apple with the skin and a meat and the seeds or whatever CPH puts up.
There to have me outside being hung from the tree for saying that.
No, we won't do that. No. Yeah. But not... Not yet, anyways. But we always say, well, the Trinity... Well, we have to figure out God mathematically. No, God's bigger than math. He's not subject to math. He made it. He's bigger than it. Same thing with eternity. Or where did God come from? These scientific questions. Why can't we dissect God? Well, God's not dissectable. That's sort of the whole shocking thing of the incarnation. The undissectable God was nailed to a tree. And it's mind-boggling stuff. But you just can't wrap your head around it. That's the way it ought to be.
Carl Sagan did.
Oh, Carl, good for him. Yeah, nice job. Way to go, Carl.
The problem is that if you go down the scientific route to try to explain God, you're imposing man-made rules and regulations on God.
I would actually go so far as to say you're imposing God-made rules on God. So I think God created stuff, and science is...
Science, as we know it, has come about from our understanding of what creation is.
Sure, I suppose so, yeah. But I think we can say things like, well, everything in science is a theory, I suppose. But there's some things that it's really hard to de-theorize. For example, red and or yellow and blue make green. I think we can scientifically say that's true. Most of the time when my kids color with those colors, it does make that. Sometimes it makes brown, which I don't quite understand. But generally speaking, yellow, yeah, there's other colors perhaps.
Or in bodies.
Yeah, but there are some scientific rules that we can just say... Yeah, that's the rule. 1 + 1 = 1. I know now we have all kinds of fancy math that says that's not true either. But okay, whatever. At the end of the day, the rules are the rules. They're built into the creation. I'm reading this 119th Psalm is my psalm for this week. your word, O Lord, is firmly set in the heavens. Like, nothing's changing your word. Right? That's a very interesting thing. Your creation is set up. Not that that's the word, but the creation, it operates according to rules that God has made. God's the one in charge of them, right? And so, but he's not bound by them. He's bigger than his rules. Go ahead.
Well, the interesting thing is that in the Renaissance, the great thinkers thought there was a God and looked for rules because there was a creation.
That's right, that's right.
Okay, that was the reason that they went looking for it.
Yeah.
Otherwise, they would have had no faith that there was any kind of rule that always worked.
Yeah.
Okay. And now, Carl Sagan will tell you, you don't need that any longer. We've got all the answers. You know, we know how the whole thing worked, from the Big Bang on down, and, you know, there's no God.
And yet, Einstein, who was a man of God, talked about something he called spooky science. And to this day, science doesn't know. It's the boson or the quark in quantum mechanics. It shows up in two different places at the same time. There's no explanation for that, and I've read scientists saying, unless we can figure this out, this goes back to Einstein, who was a man of God, saying there's something else going on here, like God.
They grammatically put it into chronological order.
Spooky science. They grammatically put what?
The scientists say 43 billion years
ago. Yeah. The nice thing about that is that if you can't figure out how something evolves, you just need to add a couple million years and everything kind of works itself out. However many you need. But the point here in all of this is simply to say, because as soon as we start talking science, I'm so far out of my realm and I get nervous. The whole point here is simply to say, whatever scientists discover, no matter how hard they work at it, it does not ever disprove God. It just simply can't, because that's a whole other field of work. For a scientist to say we don't need God anymore because we can explain something is two different categories. Does that make sense? That's a sentence that starts off with philosophy and ends with scientific theory. And those are two things that I don't understand quite how they work alongside. I mean, we disprove God because we can't see him. Well, that's kind of been one of the things all along, you know. I mean, you scientists just figured out we can't see God. Good for you. Like, I don't. This doesn't mean anything.
Science and God, it's a worthless discussion. Because why would they do that? I mean, we have science, and we have God, and they cannot ever. Science has not quite ever proved, as you just said earlier, the existence or non-existence of God. Why would they even go there? It's all political.
There's a marvelous book. That just because I tell you the title, I know none of you will read it. The Domestication of Transcendence. How about that for a title of a book? The Domestication of Transcendence. It is a phenomenal book. The Domestication, like you domesticate a dog, of transcendence. And so you put God on a leash. The book is about how three major theologians, Aquinas, Luther, and Calvin, fought to maintain this teaching of God's transcendence, that you cannot wrap your head around it. You just believe, you let it go, you believe it. And it's phenomenal that he puts Aquinas in there, because Aquinas wrote a lot of stuff. But then how they're the students of these men get it all wrong, because they move from faith to explanation, or they take theological categories and then begin to impose philosophical or scientific or for lack of a better word, reasonable categories into things that are kind of beyond reason, you know. And so it's just kind of an interesting thing to think about. When theologians start setting dates for the age of the world, they're out of their school too. This should be reminded. This cuts both ways. I don't think we need billions of years, but at the same time, I don't think we theologians need to be correcting scientists on stuff they're working pretty hard at and learning some things that, you know, are useful for us to know. The problem we'll have with things like evolution and those sorts of things is it really cuts into a lot of other stuff as well. But we should have no problem saying things like, yeah, six-day creation is fine. How many years ago was that six-day creation? I don't know. not 6,000 or whatever we have. So who knows? So stuff we're thinking about. Okay.
How long's a day, Pastor?
How long's a day? Right now, it is 24 hours. From what I understand, it used to be something less than that. Is that correct? It's like 24 hours and so many milliseconds, and that has changed. Is that correct?
Well, it's got to be over 24 hours because every 4 years we have to add a day.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Also, what about this? What about daylight savings?
Well, that's
those animals hated. Yeah, that's what really becomes a very curious question. That is beyond, again, now I'm nervous because I don't know what to do with that.
So the notion of a day is time from daylight to daylight.
Yeah.
Which depends on the rotational velocity of the earth.
Uh-huh.
No, not of the sun, just of the earth.
Uh-huh.
So that which is slowing down. Yeah.
Oh, curious. So the rotation of the earth, and so that's why they think that's why they can set dates for kind of what they think will be the end of this thing, because it will slow down to a certain point and not rotate anymore, or to a degree that's necessary to sustain life.
I haven't heard a prediction like that.
I've just heard them say I've heard them say that this earth has so many billions of years left or something like this, and so I'm just...
That's true of the sun.
Oh! One of them's got to go first, I suppose. Yeah.
Yeah, the lady in the astronomy class said, "How many years did you say we have left?" And he said, 5 billion. She said, "Oh, I thought you said million. Thank goodness."
Yes! I love it. That's a great line. That is a great line. I love that. Is fantastic. All right.
But we do add leap seconds.
That's an actual thing. That's
every couple of years we add a leap second because the Earth is spinning slower. And the definition of a day and divided in all the hours and minutes was done when the Earth was rotating faster.
Interesting. That's very interesting.
It is a measurable amount even in human scale. Wow. So when you say, how many years ago God created things in 6 days, that's not even the same.
You're not talking 24-hour category. I mean, it's a whole other category of things.
I'm just questioning, maybe a day doesn't always mean the same thing.
Well, yeah, the trick with that is when we say day there in... There's the word Hebrew, the word for day, yom, there's no vague, it's not vague. It means 6 days means 6 days. And so then when you get... And the reason I can say that from the Old Testament is because of all the teachings on the Sabbath day. So when God rests on the seventh day and then tells the people to do likewise, he's not saying rest for anything other than a sun up to sundown day. That's what's meant there. Although what's curious is, I mean, sort of, we have this hardcore fundamentalist track right now. It says it's 6 days, 7,000 years ago, that's it. 7 days, 7,000 years, whatever, that's it. Augustine, who I don't think we should doubt his faith at all, Augustine said, "Oh, that's that Genesis. God didn't need 6 days. He just said it, and it was done." How about that? So Augustine's like, "We don't need." He's going like in the opposite direction, and he's saying it's a beautiful poem that talks about what God did in a second. You know, it's curious. I like to keep my paperwork, so I subscribe to the 6 day. No, I'm just kidding. I mean, I think Genesis is to be taken literally. I really do. I've tried to get out of it, and I kind of can't. However, I don't think what we should do is sit down and say that there's nothing to what Keith is saying, and that's all just science. Like, no, there's actually a lot of wisdom, and we're actually learning something in that. That's stuff to pursue and embrace and learn from. And the church, I think, always has this sort of... Actually, I don't know if this is the church as much as the media portrays science versus the church. I don't think that's a real thing. I think that's a creation. It can be a thing, but like when they always, look at the medieval time and what they did to, who's the guy? Copernicus? They were mean to? Galileo. Galileo, like, wasn't he funded by the church? I mean, the Pope didn't like some of the stuff he said. Oh, because he changed it from, it's the Copernicus. It's Copernicus, the Copernican Revolution. Yeah. And so,
the Earth isn't the center of the universe.
Copernicus wasn't like anti-Jesus or something. He's like, I got this new theory. And some people, the media uprising, made the Pope nervous or something. But I think like Luther even, think it's the same era. Luther was like, ah, that's interesting stuff. You know, he wasn't. The church didn't all oppose him in the way it's always described. Now, sometimes scientists got burnt at the stake, but in those days, who didn't? So there you go. All right. Good heavens, where are we? There's nothing about what we talked about this morning, Marjorie. What have you done? Can you guys give me, I know, we're at time. Can you give me 10 minutes? Because here's the thing. We're not going to meet until January after tonight. We're not going to meet on Thanksgiving Eve, and then it's Advent, and we'll have services. So you guys, I know you're not busy on Wednesday nights, because I know what you do on Wednesday, so I hope to see you here for our services at 7:15.
I know your deeds.
I know your deeds. That's right. That's right. I love it. Nice work. Excellent tie-in. But, so give me 10 minutes. Let's get through Laodicea. If we don't finish tonight, I'll encourage you to show up on Sunday, where I promise I will do it. That's a weak promise.
Yeah.
I know your works are neither hot nor cold. Now, given what I just told you about water in the area, what does hot or cold mean? When you hear hot or cold, you think you're either on fire or turning a cold shoulder to it, right? It's like whenever I would ask girls out in high school, like a cold meant not that they were like wanting to go out with me, right? It's always a cold shoulder was something very different. And it was never a hot answer. But hot is sort of like on fire for something, and cold is we are against you. We're not really could care less about you. That's not what's going on here. It would be strange for Jesus to say, I wish you were either on fire for this or just rejecting it altogether. Why would Jesus wish anyone to reject something altogether? The cold there, think of what we read about in Colossae, that they had those cool, refreshing streams watering the whole place. If you live in Laodicea and you hear about cold water when you have all that murky, lukewarm stuff, that's not a negative thing. Like, you want that water. So what Jesus is probably saying here is, with the cold reference, you are not giving people the refreshment of the gospel, nor are you hot. And we've talked about this somewhere before. The hot springs have a medicinal effect that they're healing. So you're not healing people with the Word of God, and you're not refreshing people with the Word of God. You're not doing anything with the Word of God. You're like letting the coffee sit out for 3 days. It's lukewarm. It's gross. No one wants to drink it anymore. I'm going to spit you out. See? Now, what causes them to be lukewarm? Judging from what we read here, their love for their riches and their prosperity. Their wealth has caused them to not really depend on God very much. Yeah, Dave.
Well, not to slow it down too much, but they were an extremely wealthy city. And in fact, after one of the notes I have here, after the earthquake that virtually destroyed the place, they actually refused imperial help from Rome to rebuild the city, and they did it themselves.
Because they could afford to do it themselves.
Because they had so much money.
So let's just say this. They were very wealthy, very comfortable, pulled themselves up by their own bootstraps to make themselves who they were. I wonder if we could find an association with a country or part of California that's like that now. Anywho, who is... Oh, it's too bad Cecily's not here. Don't tell Cecily this ever happened. She'll watch it. You're right. Hi, Cecily. Francis Chan would berate his church in Simi Valley there for being lukewarm Christians all the time. And I'm not sure I agree with everything he said, but I do think where he's right is that we who are here in America and comfortable and wealthy and as Art so aptly pointed out this morning, judging one another by what car we drive, et cetera, et cetera, we are very comfortable and we are very secure, and we so very often break the first commandment, which is you shall have no other gods before me, because we fear, love, and trust our money more than God. And that's, go ahead, Marjorie. Yeah.
I was just going to say this morning the word that came forward was complacent.
Yeah,
and I think that's such a good word for that.
Yeah, I think it's a complacency because we don't want to lose what we have. We're far too comfortable with what we've got. Go ahead.
I would say that we don't even know what we have, most of us.
Yeah, yeah.
I was reading an article just the other day that said if you make more than $77 a year, you make more than 80% of the people.
80%, that's right.
In the world.
Yeah.
There's a... not a poem, but an article that was sent to me years ago that talked about the fact that if you had a pair of shoes, you know, you're so much better off than this percentage of people. If you can read, you're so much better off than this percentage. Yeah. It's amazing.
Yeah.
And we don't recognize it.
We don't praise God for it, but we don't recognize it.
No, no. So we say, "Give us this day our daily bread," and we're not. Am I talking to God or Ralph? Like, I can't remember, right? Because it's just there. We're not actually nervous. Even now, I mean, I'm curious. How many of you have really cut down on your usage of water? Nuts, I'm the only one. Okay. How many of you would cut down on your use of water if you had three kids in the house? Please just make me feel a little bit better about this.
That's difficult.
But I mean, I would bet that the amount of water we use is not all... we're never really making much of a dent in that thing anyways. But the point is... So frankly, I don't know how to use less water. I mean, I have to cut back on water. I'm not really sure how to do that, you know. We just don't have this kind of dependency on God in any sort of perceivable way. So it's a very hard truth to say everything you have, every good gift cometh from the Lord. Yeah, but also because I worked hard, you know, also because I got a paycheck, you know, and God could just take your breath away if he wants, you know. I mean, these are things we just can think about. Esther, yeah.
When you brush your teeth, don't run the water.
Okay, thank you. All right. I'll brush my teeth in the shower or something. I don't know. You ever see the episode of Seinfeld? Ever see the episode in Seinfeld where he starts making salad in the shower? Kramer?
Wash the salad.
And, yeah, so he could like kill two birds. And they're having dinner and they're like, "Kramer, this salad's amazing." He's like, "Thanks, I just made it in the shower." Okay. Okay, so... This is a judgment that I think that we actually personally need to actually pray about and think about, because this is something that we need to be aware of, that even if we are not at the particular lukewarmness of Laodicea, the temptation is there and the ability to slip into that is always there here in America and in the church. We're comfortable and complacent and we don't want to lose that. So there you go. Okay. Tom had a phrase earlier, just a couple seconds ago. I think that's useful here. We don't realize how good we have it. That's part of the Laodicean issue. They don't realize how bad they have it. You say, "I'm rich and I have prospered. I need nothing," not realizing you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked. Remember, it's Christ's judgments that matter more than our perceptions. So this is true on a gospel side where you say, "I feel guilty and shamed and there's no way God could love me." And Christ says, "Ah, but you're baptized. I've died for you. You're forgiven and a child of God. You're loved." I don't feel that way. That's not the point. I see you this way. See, that's the gospel side of it. Here, the law side of it is, I'm comfortable and cozy and warm. And Jesus saying, "You're pitiable, poor, wretched, and blind. You don't see things the way they really are." I think the blind one is, blind and naked are significant words to end on. You don't see things rightly. And when we think naked in the Bible, who first notices that they're naked?
Adam.
You don't even realize that. You're so far gone, you think those fig leaves are pulling something off. See, they're in a real bad place. Because they don't recognize it. And this is something I think is very sobering for us in the American church and in the more Parkian church to think about. This is a call to repentance. Now, notice this, that he has not spit them out yet. He's still sloshing around in his mouth. I don't know.
It says in here, the words actually vomit.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful.
Then,
the word is vomit. I'm about to vomit you out of my mouth. "Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline, so be zealous and repent." He says here, "I counsel you to buy from me gold refined by fire and the white garments and the salve to anoint your eyes." He's saying this to them, and he's not saying do good works to earn your way back in. He's saying repent. It's just a way to tell rich people to repent. You're purchasing the wrong things. There's I forget where it is now. In one of the prophets, he says something to the effect of, "You have spent your money in all the wrong places. to Ephraim. You're buying this and you're buying that. And you're finding security in that. And you don't even care about God anymore because you have everything you need. And Isaiah 60, I think it's Isaiah 60, maybe it's in Isaiah 44, one of these places. Jesus, or God, Christ, calls the people to himself saying, come to me and buy, you who are thirsty, come and buy drink that you can't, I got to look it up, sorry.
Buy without money.
Buy without money is essentially the verse. Come take what's for free. And here this call to repentance is that. You're putting your hope and your security, your faith, hope, and trust, your fear, love, and trust, to use Luther's catechetical language. That stuff is in your money and your stuff and your things. Come to me and take what's free, what's actual wealth, what actually matters. Come to me and hear what I have to say to you. What is the text? Isaiah 55, there it is. I'm letting you out of here real quick. Just give me a second. This is very important. It's very helpful. Isaiah 55, 1 through 3. Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. He who has no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear that your soul may live, and I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast love for David. Incline your ear to me, come to me, hear, and your soul may live. What does it mean to buy from Christ? It means to listen, to hear, to receive by grace. See, go ahead.
And this verse 2, why spend money on what is not bread?
Yeah.
What does Jesus say? I am the
bread of life. Yeah, very good, very good. Very good. So, Jesus says, with these harsh words, I'm disciplining you because I love you. And sometimes children need to be more disciplined, or they need a harsher word to wake them up. Sometimes harsher words are necessary.
Sometimes for as adults.
That's right, yeah, yeah. So Jesus were to come along and say, oh, don't worry, y'all. You're forgiven. It's cool. Well, that just sounds nice and down home.
No. All y'all.
All right. Let's see. Notice how they think they're blessed probably because of all of their stuff. What blessing is found, we read this morning, I'm not going to get to that now. But to be blessed according to the New Testament is not to be financially set, it's to be in the presence of Christ. And where is Christ in this story here with Laodicea? Outside knocking on the door. Hey, will somebody let me in? I stand at the door and knock because I've been locked out of the church. You think you're in there with all those blessings because I gave them to you. I'm still out here. Now, to the one who lets me in, I will dine with them. We may have a Lord's Supper allusion there. But I think it is significant to note that the standing on the door and knocking is not an evangelistic verse, that Jesus is standing on the door of your heart waiting for you to open up and let him in. But rather, this is to a church that's almost at the point of needing evangelism because they're almost being spit away from Christ, vomited out. They're almost being cast off from Christ. But Jesus is saying, hey, I love you. Let me back in. I will grant the one who conquers, the one who repents and believes, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne. As I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And there we again have that idea of ruling with Christ. Okay? Okay, good. Thanks for giving me that extra time. It's a good stopping point for us. It would be strange to start in the middle of the Laodicean letter in January. So we're at a good stopping point. We'll take our Christmas break and be back at it in January. Be looking out for Dave's emails. Okay? Should we close with the doxology?
Yes.
All right, let's sing. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly hosts.
Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks for listening to this Bible study presentation from Faith Lutheran Church in Moore Park, California. We hope this has helped you grow in your Christian faith and study of the Bible. For more information, visit us on the web at faithmoorpark.com.
Music by Kevin MacLeod.